El sun is here. Ladies and gentlemen, in 5 minutes, we will be starting our program. So we'll be waiting for others to join. So let's start, okay? Okay, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone, wherever you are. Welcome to the 15th Pan-Asia Farmers Exchange Program. Today is our final session of the five-day webinar, and we are happy to know that many of us continue to join. Thank you so much. I am your moderator for today. I am Thelma Soriano, and I am the Seed Regulatory Affairs Director of CropLife Asia. I'd like to welcome all the participants from Australia, China, Korea, Taiwan, Philippines, Indonesia, Thailand, India, and Pakistan. And for our participants from Vietnam, you may listen to the Vietnamese interpretation by clicking the interpretation icon below of your screen, and then you can choose the Japanese. So, before I introduce our first speaker, let me just give you some points to remember for the duration of the program. Please type your question at the Q&A tab anytime. And then questions will be answered at the end of the presentations. If there are questions that are not accommodated during the session, due to time constraints, this will be answered through our chat box or email. E-certificates will be given only to participants who will be able to attend the 5-day program. And certificates will be sent to you through your registered email address. Every day, there will be a $20 question at the end of the session. So stay tuned until our session ends. Okay, so today's topic is crop improvement and seed quality, a virtual tour to GeneBank and seed processing plant. As we all know, crop improvement is one of the most urgent tasks in plant breeding to meet the ever-increasing demands for plant-derived products. So to start the discussion, we have a team of experts from the International Rice Research Institute, or IRRI, who will talk about the importance of the GeneBank and will give us a virtual tour. And I will be giving you the IRRI team of experts, the name of the IRRI team of experts who will be joining us today. Ma'am Eileen Garcia, the manager or the project coordination and stakeholder advocacy, Healthier Rice Program. Selfa Marie Bombais, Marionette Alana, Norman Oliva, Ana Maria Reynoso, Amiri Amparado, and Dr. Beno Prasad Ramea, the Research Unit Leader of Future Genetic Resources at IRRI. So, actually, the tour is one of the activities in Farmers Exchange Program that we conduct every year to help our participants become familiar with the importance of GeneBank in crop improvement and importance of seed quality. So IRRI team, the floor is yours.
Good day, everyone. Can you hear me well?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yes. Okay. Good day, everyone. On behalf of the Healthier Rice Program of the International Rice Research Institute, it is my pleasure to welcome you all to this afternoon's activity of the Pan-Asia Farmers Exchange Program. My name is Anna. I will be your host and moderator, and I will be supported by my IRRI colleagues as our virtual tour progresses. As you can see on your screens, we have an aerial view of the International Rice Research Institute campus, and it was founded in 1960 by two American foundations. We have the Ford Foundation and the Rockefeller Foundation in partnership with the Philippine government. So Los Baños, Laguna, Philippines was the chosen site among other rice-producing and rice-consuming regions in Asia. Well, due to its proximity to the University of the Philippines, Los Baños, or UPLB, which back then was the premier agricultural university in Asia. As a matter of fact, the IRRI headquarters sits on a 200-hectare land, which includes an upland and lowland experiment stations, which is located next to the university. To date, our workforce is composed of about 1,000 staff from 37 countries. And while our headquarters is based in the Philippines, we do keep our collaborations robust and our international presence strong through our 16 country offices sprawled across Asia and East Africa. However, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, the Institute has been operating at a limited capacity. And because of this and other travel-related restrictions, we are unable to receive visitors at the moment. I am pleased to inform you that our team has put together a very special virtual tour of IRRI to take you through the facilities that have been instrumental in taking us on the road to Golden Rice. So our tour will focus on three facilities. We have the International Rice Gene Bank, the Genetic Transformation Laboratory, and the Transgenic Screenhouse. So at each station, we will be joined by a resource person. And then towards the end of our tour, we will have a designated time a designated discussion period to answer questions that you may have. So I would just like to remind everyone to please send your questions through the chat box on this meeting. Another reminder, most of the photos and video materials that you're about to see, these were recorded pre-pandemic. So you might notice the absence of mouth covering or physical distancing, and it's because of that. During the previous years that we welcomed the participants of the Farmers Exchange at IRRI, this is how we did the tour. We have our participants in a trailer, and this is driven by a tractor, and then we drive around 300 meters to our laboratory. So we will now proceed to our first site, to the International Rice Gene Bank. Please welcome my colleague, Ms. Monette Alana.
Good afternoon from the International Rice Gene Bank, or the IRRI Gene Bank, located in the Nile Sea Brady Laboratory. I am Monette Alana, Associate Scientist, Gene Bank Seed Management. I will help you navigate this important resource center at IRRI. The IRRI Gene Bank is the world's biggest collection of rice genetic diversity in the world. It holds 132,140 accessions of rice as of September 2021. This includes cultivated species of modern rice, traditional varieties, and wild species. Countries from all over the world send their rice seed samples to IRRI for safekeeping and for sharing for the common public good. It is an essential resource for food security, as the conserved germplasm is used to develop and improve new varieties that are higher yielding or are more resistant to pests, diseases, and stresses of climate change. Established in 1971, the IRRI Gene Bank and associated laboratories, offices, and supporting facilities are over 40 years old, but has been operating at the highest approved international standards. Here are the current figures of some of the contributions to the Gene Bank. An exact copy of IRRI Gene Bank's collection is stored in the Svalbard Global Seed Vault in Norway. The most recent IRRI deposit, the Svalbard Vault, was made in February 2020, just before the pandemic, by Dr. Benupar Sadramaya, Research Unit Leader of Feed for Future Genetic Resources at IRRI. If you have questions on this, Dr. Benu is with us later in this session and will be happy to answer questions you may have. Traditional varieties and wild species of rice are being lost through genetic erosion. Farmers adapt new varieties and stop growing varieties that they have used and nurtured for generations, and eventually lose these varieties. Wild species are threatened with extinction as their habitats are destroyed by human disturbance. Future crop improvement needs genetic variation from traditional varieties and related wild species to cope with the many biotic and abiotic stresses that challenge rice production around the world. By collecting and conserving rice germplasm, this is how IRRI GeneBank safeguards genetic diversity and improves crops. With access to the world's largest collection of rice, we have a unique opportunity to study the diversity of rice. Scientists characterize rice for its traits and genetic makeup to find useful versions of genes and determine the best method of improving the rice variety, whether through conventional breeding or more precise breeding techniques like genetic engineering or gene editing. In the case of golden rice, genetic engineering was used because the screening of rice germplasm showed that beta-carotene is not present in traditional rice varieties. Each type of rice in the IRRI GeneBank is stored in both the base and active collections. The base collection is used for long-term storage and maintained at negative 20 degrees Celsius, while the active collection stores seeds available for distribution at 2 to 4 degrees Celsius. At IRRI GeneBank, rice seeds have the potential to remain viable for many decades. Viability testing of all samples is carried out every 5 years for seeds stored in the active collection or every 10 years for seeds stored in the base collection. If viability falls below 85%, samples of the remaining seeds are planted to produce fresh seeds for storage. IRRI shares seeds of small quantities free of charge on demand to any individual or organization anywhere in the world for purposes of research, breeding, or training for agriculture. Because of the limitation of seed multiplication during this pandemic period, only limited seeds are available for distribution. As the staffing and operations increase at a higher capacity, more seeds will be available for sharing. Over to you, Norman, at the Genetic Transformation Laboratory.
Hi, I'm Norman Oliva, Senior Associate Scientist at the Genetic Transformation Lab, or GTL. GTL is central to our work on genetic engineering. The lab is instrumental in conducting the molecular characterization and safety assessment dossier used in the regulatory application for golden rice. It is also leading the work in high iron and zinc rice. I hope you can recall Dr. Russell Ranke's presentation last Monday about golden rice, where he discussed the journey of golden rice from its early stages, its development over the years, and final approval in selected countries. Biofortification is the process of nutritionally improving rice. Golden rice has been biofortified through genetic modification. I shall now show you the toolbox for developing genetically engineered rice for improved nutrition. The first step is gene cloning, in which the gene of interest is replicated in preparation for transfer. DNA or RNA is extracted from the organism, and the target gene is isolated by PCR technique. Next is agrobacterium transformation and the tissue culture process. The gene of interest is combined with the appropriate rice promoter to regulate the gene expression and inserted into the agrobacterium PI plasmid. The expression vector for agrobacterium transformation of rice is analyzed by restriction analysis and sequencing. Immature rice embryos are co-cultivated for 7 days with the agrobacterium containing the gene of interest. Once they have sufficiently germinated, transgenic cell lines are selected and regenerated into plant. This can take up to 70 to 75 days. Transgenic plants develop from separate single cells, or what we call independent events, are grown hydroponically for 2 weeks and subjected to PCR molecular analysis for the presence of the gene. Plants are transplanted to grow into maturity. Normal and fertile plants are selected for further molecular analysis of single copy gene and gene expression. The off types, or the ones that do not grow to maturity, are discarded following strict biosafety protocols. Once the plants are mature enough, they are transplanted in our transgenic greenhouse facility, which you will see shortly. IRRI is accredited by the Excellence for Stewardship Program, a global organization that promotes adoption of product stewardship programs and quality management. The Genetic Transformation Lab was responsible for conducting the molecular characterization and safety assessment tests for the regulatory applications of golden rice. These results were published in Nature Scientific Reports in 2020. Internationally accepted standards for the safety assessment of genetically engineered food crops involve the molecular characterization of the inserted DNA and an evaluation on the allergenicity and toxicity of the newly expressed proteins from the genetic transformation. A complete analysis indicates that the inserted DNA was introduced without modification and the trait was stably inherited across multiple generations. Comparative analysis and laboratory tests demonstrate that the new proteins in the GR2E golden rice grains are as safe as any existing proteins in ordinary rice. This study supports the conclusion made by regulators in New Zealand, Australia, Canada, the United States of America, and the Philippines that food derived from golden rice is as safe as food derived from conventional rice varieties. Over to you, Amory. Let me turn you over to Amory, our greenhouse facility resource person.
Good afternoon, everyone. The last facility we are visiting in the is the IRRI transgenic greenhouse, which is used for confined testing activities and for introgression of golden rice into popular local rice varieties. Good afternoon, I am Amory Amparado, your assistant scientist in the Healthier Rice Program at IRRI and your transgenic greenhouse resource person. The transgenic greenhouse is where we grow genetically engineered rice varieties like golden rice. In previous years, we've conducted confined tests as part of the biosafety regulatory process. This was done to demonstrate that golden rice is as safe as ordinary rice, with the added benefit of beta carotene in its grain. Our studies show that agronomic yield and grain quality traits of golden rice are the same as its ordinary rice counterparts. To bring golden rice from proof to concept to a market variety, scientists and breeders at IRRI, Philippine Department of Agriculture, PhilRice, and the Bangladesh Rice Research Institute introduced the beta-carotene producing GR2E golden rice trait to popular inbred rice varieties through marker-assisted back crossbreeding. These days, we are growing golden rice to produce the seeds that will be used in the pilot scale deployment. And like you, we are very much excited to see golden rice move closer and closer to the people who need it to the most. Back to you, Anna.
Thank you, Amory, Norman, and Monette. We hope that this virtual tour has added to your knowledge of golden rice and the process of biofortification. If there are some points that need clarification, we have IRRI scientists in the session who will be happy to take your questions. So another reminder, if you have comments or questions, please send them through the chat box in this meeting. And apart from our three resource persons, we also have in attendance Dr. Venu Prasad Ramaya, Research Unit Leader of Future Genetic Resources at IRRI. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Venu.
Thank you, Anna. Glad to be here.
Thank you. So we're just waiting for questions from our group, our participants, or other panelists.
Okay, so thank you, IRRI team. But I'd like to acknowledge first Dr. Bilan Turkel of Advocacy and Branding Unit of IRRI. And that was an excellent visiting experience at IRRI. And it's good that the technology allowed us to have a virtual trip like this, despite the situation today. So now for the question and answer portion, let me remind everyone to type their questions in the Q&A box located at the bottom of your screen so we can direct it to our IRRI team speakers. Since our time is limited, so we will request the IRRI team to kindly stand by to the Q&A session so we can wait for others to provide their questions. So we will move on to our next topic, but please don't worry because our IRRI team will answer your questions and later they will be joining us in the panel discussion. Moving on, our next speaker is Dr. Tony Alfonso, who will talk about the importance of seed quality. And he will give us a virtual tour of a seed processing facility in Tarlac. Doc Tony is the Regulatory and Stewardship Manager at Corteva AgriScience in the Philippines. He is also responsible primarily for seeds regulatory, both for import and cultivation. He is also involved in crop protection regulatory, policy advocacy, product stewardship, and compliance. Prior to joining Pioneer Hybrid Philippines 6 years ago, he worked as plant breeder at the Philippine Rice Research Institute, where he led several projects, including golden rice, in collaboration with the Golden Rice Network from its inception in 2004 until 2015. He earned his PhD in plant molecular biology from Cornell University in New York and his master's in genetics from the University of the Philippines. He is also the chair of the CropLife Philippines Seeds and Biotech Committee. So let us all welcome Dr. Tony. Dr. Tony, the floor is yours.
Yep. Thank you so much, Tia Thelma, for the kind introduction. And let me say hello to all the participants. I'd like to thank CropLife and BCP for inviting me once again to talk about GM corn seed production. Let me share my screen. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, we can, Dr.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Yeah, so a large part of my presentation is a video showing activities in the field and in the seed processing plant until we come up with this pack of high quality seeds as final products that we then offer to our farmers for planting. I'm trying to advance my slide. Yeah, so just very quickly about Corteva AgriScience. We are a pure play agriculture company that brings together the strengths of legacy companies Pioneer, DuPont, and Dow AgroSciences. Our purpose is to enrich the lives of those who produce and those who consume, ensuring progress for generations to come. And we are guided by these six core values. The importance of selecting the right varieties suitable for a particular growing environment cannot be overemphasized. Availability of high quality seeds is an indicator of a strong and mature seed industry that exists in parallel with agricultural growth and productivity. On the other hand, planting of low quality seeds will certainly reduce yield and make farmers lose a good opportunity for a bountiful harvest at the end of the cropping season. I won't dwell so much on this slide, but here you see the a list of the attributes of high quality seeds. Seed companies implement quality seed programs to ensure that quality standards are met to help ensure of having populations of healthy and uniform plants in the field. Seed production entails careful and accurate demand and supply planning, execution of field and plant operations, taking into account quality control standards and procedures by technically proficient staff. To be able to do this, superior germplasm must be available. And for big scale seed production, modern processing facilities and equipment are also a must. In addition to internal company standards, seed companies also comply with the government mandated quality certifications, biosafety registration for GM crops, and additional registration, for example, those containing plant incorporated protectants or PIPs. Biotech seeds also need to implement stewardship activities, such as insect resistance management, to prolong the usefulness of the technology or delay the development of insect resistance. Product stewardship is something that perpetrators of counterfeit or illegal seeds don't comply with. The proliferation of low quality, fake, or illegally produced seeds in recent years not only compromise crop productivity, but also take advantage of our farmers. Unfortunately, the social media has become a selling ground for such seeds, in many cases violating laws, government guidelines, and intellectual property rights. It's worth mentioning, though, that there's this ongoing government initiative to regulate online selling by coming up with a joint admin order involving several government agencies. Okay, I will play a video. So that's just a brief overview about the importance of high quality seeds. I will play a video showing various activities in the field and in the seed processing plant. But before that, let me just mention that Corteva's seed production plant is located in Visita Industrial Park here in Tarlac City, where we have a seed testing facility accredited by ISTA. The seed processing plant has facilities for post-harvest processing, cleaning and packaging, seed storage, and seed testing. Let me now play the video showing the entire process of producing high quality seeds. I need to stop sharing, yeah, here. And share again. Play.
A satisfied farmer will always be a loyal farmer. Pioneer corn farmers, always satisfied with the quality of our corn seed products, have all consistently remained loyal to us over many seasons and years. Each Pioneer corn seed goes through a very intricate process to make sure that quality and customer satisfaction are ingrained. Customer loyalty is never shortchanged. And this is how we do it.
This is how we do it.
Land preparation. The process starts with land preparation. Land preparation should be done as soon as the soil is at its right moisture, not too dry and not too wet. For light soil, two-disc harrowing at a desired depth of 6 to 8 inches is the minimum requirement to achieve pulverized soil. If needed, conduct third harrowing. Finally, level the field to ensure uniformity of crop stand and soil moisture distribution. Furrow setting. Furrow should be set with a prescribed distance of 60 centimeters between rows. Distribution and infield canals should also be constructed to facilitate the irrigation of standing crop.
To avoid confusion during planting, mark male rows by staking the two ends of the row. Parent seeds preparation. Compute parent seed requirement with allowance to ensure sufficiency of seeds for planting. The seeds are then treated based on the recommended requirement. Irrigation. Irrigation before planting. If soil is too dry, irrigate field to achieve enough and uniform soil moisture. This will ensure uniform seed emergence. Irrigation for standing crop. Identify if there is a need for irrigation using the feel method. To do this, get a soil sample and compact it by hand. If it breaks when the hand is opened, prepare for furrow irrigation. Ensure uniformity of irrigation to promote uniformity of plant growth. The water tender has to check the end of the furrows from time to time to avoid under or over irrigation. Basal fertilization. Basal fertilization should be conducted right before planting. If different fertilizer grades will be used, pre-mix these before application. Apply fertilizer along the rows evenly. Planting. To ensure uniformity of distance along the rows, use rolling or string markers. Using a jabber at a depth of 1.5 to 2 inches, plant seeds along the designated rows. Make sure that only one seed is placed per hill at the sloping side of the furrow. Plant only one side of the hill for a uniform distance of plants between rows. Pre-emergent herbicide application. Apply pre-emergent herbicide after planting when moisture is enough and even. This will ensure uniform coating of the herbicide in the field and its efficacy. Apply evenly over the entire field. Install a warning sign and re-entry interval after spraying. Insecticide application. Apply insecticide early in the morning when needed based on the incidence of pests and diseases. Spray evenly on leaves or other affected parts. Install a warning sign and re-entry interval after spraying. Post-emergent herbicide application. Apply herbicide when the weeds start to grow around 2 inches in height. Apply evenly along each row to ensure full coverage over the field. Use shields to protect parents without the Roundup Ready trait. Side dressing. Side dressing should be conducted as scheduled. Place fertilizer approximately 2 to 3 inches from the base of the plant. If different fertilizer grades will be used, pre-mix these before application. Hilling up. Hilling up should be done between rows to aerate soil 22 to 25 days after plant. Hilling up is mostly done just after side dressing the remaining recommended amount of nitrogen. Roguing. Roguing must be conducted following the schedule stated in the batch plan, which are as follows. Roguing 1 at 10 days after planting. Remove multiple seedlings, leaving only the healthiest. Rogue all the volunteers coming from the leftover ears from previous corn crop. Roguing 2 at 25 days after planting. Remove off types along both male and female rows. Roguing 3 at 40 days after planting. Remove off types and runts along male and female rows. Roguing 4 at 47 days after planting. Remove all remaining off types and runts prior to detasseling. Roguing should be done one row at a time. Detasseling. Conduct detasseling using the leaf pulling hood based on the data collected from the field. Leaf pull plants when tassels are covered with only 2 to 3 leaves based on the following standards. At 0% silking, pull at least 85% of tassels at first pass. At less than or equal to 3% silking, pull at least 95% of tassels. At less than or equal to 5% silking, pull at least 99.5% of the tassels. Harvesting. Harvest is done by opening the husk and removing the ear. Harvested ears are then collected and placed in net sacks hanging from the harvester's waists. The harvested plants are bent down by stepping on its base. When the net sack is full, it is poured into another net sack. It should then be tied and lined up along the male rows for ease in inspection of leftovers. The filled net sacks are piled by the grower and hauled to a designated weighing area. Field weighing. Key information in the Harvest Receiving Report, or HRR, should be noted before weighing starts. Piled net sacks are weighed by batches of 10. Each reading is recorded in the HRR. Loading and delivery of harvest. Prior to loading, make sure that the truck is clean and free from any other corn seeds or grains. When loading the harvest, untie the net sacks and unload the ears. Load up to the height of the side of the truck. Ensure that all sides of the truck are properly secured and harvest is covered with net or tarpaulin before departure. Receiving. Upon arrival of the truck, the harvest will be inspected and logged by the security personnel on duty and will be verified by the receiving personnel for accuracy of information. Once verified, the truck is weighed and moved to truck tilter for unloading. The truck will be positioned at the tilter to unload corn on the vibratory conveyor. Dumped corn ears are conveyed towards the sorting building to remove undesirable ears, husks, and other plant materials. Good ears are sampled to determine moisture content for proper drying management, while the bulk of sorted corn ears are transported towards dryer bins for drying. Information on corn ears loaded in dryer bins are once again verified and encoded in the seed drying computer program. Corn ears are dried using a mechanical dryer, which can be a single pass or two pass dryer. The mechanical dryer uses fuels like cobs, diesel, and LPG to provide hot air and reduce moisture. Temperature inside the dryer is maintained by the operators with the help of predictions and indications generated by the computer program to sustain the viability of seeds. Seed drying lasts from 4 to 5 days or until the desired moisture is achieved. Shelling. After drying, corn ears are shelled. This is where the seeds are separated from the cobs. Through load-out windows, dried corn ears are released and conveyed to the shelling building. Shelled seeds are cleaned further using a fine cleaner separating small cobs and other undesirable materials. After the cleaner, insecticide for pest protection is applied on seeds while cobs and other byproducts of shelling are transported to the cob bin for truck loading. Corn byproducts are sold to a third party as raw materials for fertilizer or feed additives. An inline sampler takes sample from clean seeds for quality testing. Box of cleaned seeds are transported to the warehouse for unloading in a 1.2 metric ton jumbo bag or 1.4 metric ton metal box for storage. To maintain viability, seeds are stored in a temperature and humidity controlled warehouse until the time when these will be moved to the next processing step. Quality assurance. Samples taken during processing are submitted to the laboratory for quality testing. Samples undergo purity tests to determine the amount of impurities and damaged seeds present. The results of these tests are taken into account to identify the need for conditioning or direct packaging. Kernel count, or number of seeds per kilo, is also taken to determine the approximate weight per bag in relation to the product packaging requirements. Conditioning. Seed lots having high amounts of undesirable lighter materials are passed through gravity. To effectively remove these, seed lots are sized first before the gravity separation. Gravity clean seeds are blended to return to the original composition of the lot. Meanwhile, seed lots with high impurities in black or light color diseases are passed through the color sorter. Packaging. After the seeds pass all quality standards, the seeds are now ready for packaging. These are then scheduled for packaging and moved out from the warehouses for processing. Before the packaging process, the seeds are treated with chemicals for protection and coloring agent as precaution that the seeds are not for consumption. Trained employees mix chemicals to form the slurry needed for seeds protection. In the seed treatment process, scheduled seeds for bagging are loaded in a bin for the treating preparation. Batch or continuous type treating equipment is used for treating to ensure the fairness of chemical application per corn kernel. Treated seeds are dispensed by an electronically controlled scale. Bags loaded with seeds run through a conveyor passing heat sealers to prevent seeds from absorbing moisture. A planting guide is also placed inside each bag, and a tag is stitched outside the bag for further information. Bags are closed through mechanical sewers and conveyed for palletizing. As each bag is conveyed, weight per bag is verified by an inline scale that rejects bags deviating from the desired weight. Using photo eyes and sensors along the conveyors, bags are palletized by a robot configured in multiple patterns. The robot continuously piles bags coming from the packing line, while an automated fork is used to feed pallets for the robot's use. Once the number of bags per pallet is completed, palletized bags are conveyed through an automated wrapping machine to provide greater stability of bags in the pallet during warehousing or delivery. Distribution. Approved delivery requests for Pioneer's authorized outlets are coursed through logistics. Identified seed lots from packaging for delivery are picked up and loaded in designated truckers for hauling to an authorized outlet that will be purchased and planted by another satisfied Pioneer corn farmer. From the field to the plant, let us again see the different steps involved in hybrid corn seed production.
Thank you, Dr. Tony, for your informative presentation and for this inspiring video. This time, we get the chance to ask questions to our IRRI team, the team of experts, and to Dr. Tony. So for everyone who wants to ask question or send a comment, kindly type it in the Q&A box. So the first question I have seen here, first question came from Ma'am Merly Palakpak. This is about illegal seeds. There is one slide saying that illegal seeds don't implement stewardship. So what our question by Ma'am Merly is, what measures are put in place to prevent the negative impact of these illegal seeds to the industry? Dr. Tony, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Ma'am Merly, for the question. So these are variously called illegal seeds, fake, counterfeit, unregistered seeds, all referring to the same thing. And this is everybody's concern, all the stakeholders, not only the industry, but also the government regulators, the farmers, the traders, because all these kinds of seeds affect the industry. And it can be addressed in so many fronts. But basically, the first, the most important action should come from the government, because being regulatory in nature, you know, having these regulatory offices from the government, they are the ones who can implement the law, who can implement the policies and guidelines of the government. The industry can only do so much, maybe coordinate with the government when it comes to reporting when, how, and where this is happening. But in terms of actual actions to go after the perpetrators of these practices, it has to come from the government. And regarding specific actions, so CropLife Philippines has put together a collection of evidence from Facebook, for example, those selling apparently unregistered GM corn, claiming to be ACV resistant or herbicide tolerant, but don't have the proper permits and documents. We can submit them to the government, DA, BPI, or the Fertilizer and Pesticide Authority for them to, you know, to understand better the extent of the problem. I mentioned about the JAO, or the Joint Admin Order, that is now being developed by the industry. It's now at an advanced stage because public consultations have just been completed. And so, and this is being led by DTI, DOH, DNR, and DA. After the public consultations, I think this will now be published in newspaper, and, you know, it will take effect, providing policies and regulations for online selling. Those are the things that I can tell you that, you know, being done to address the illegal seeds that are now proliferating in the country. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tony, and thank you, Ma'am Merle. The question is for the IRRI team. The IRRI continues to research on the genetic development of rice to alleviate hunger. So can you cite some examples on the ongoing researches on rice, and how does rice contribute to the nation's sustainable development goal? Thank you.
Okay, so basically we're having an ongoing research on developing high iron zinc rice. So that's one of the one part of the healthier rice program, where we're trying to address the iron deficiency anemia. So probably to have one of our staple food to be more nutritious. So we are also planning to stack the high iron rice with golden rice. So you have both the provitamin A enriched rice and also the high iron zinc together. So basically, we're trying just to partly contribute in the goal of providing healthier rice, healthier food for the Philippine population.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Tony. it's thank you, Sir Norman. The next question is from Sir Muhammad Kamrul Hassan. Doc Tony, this is for Doc Tony. You mentioned also that refuge compliance is one of the post-approval requirements for corn. So can you state what is in his, can you please say about refuge? So what is the role of refuge in GM corn?
Yeah, so the refuge seeds are basically the non-BT counterpart of the variety or of the product that is planted. It can be 5%, it can be 10% or 20%. It can be blended along with the main product. But the idea is to provide plants within the field that are susceptible to the target insect so that these insects can continue to feed and live within the field and produce their progenies. So they increase in number, these susceptible plants, because only susceptible plants will be able to survive in these non-BT plants. And the idea is so that there will be sufficient number or population of susceptible target insects so that if ever it happens that a resistant individual evolves within the BT plant, there is a big likelihood that that resistant insect will mate with the susceptible. So the progeny will be a heterozygous, and heterozygous insects can be easily killed by the BT trait. So by having that kind of system, you know, the evolution of a resistant individuals that will continue to proliferate, to the next generation is prevented. So it's one way of prolonging the technology and prevent the emergence and, you know, continue this resistant individuals into the next generation. That's the simplest answer to the reason why we are providing these refuge plants or susceptible plants within the BT field.
Yeah. Hey, Dr. Tony, thank you. So the next question is for IRRI team again. So how does the national government access those rice germplasm collected from their countries, from other countries?
Dr. Venu, are you still online?
Hi, Anna, yes. Thank you for the question. If I heard properly, the question is, how do the national government access
those rice germplasm collected from their countries? How do how does the national government access?
Hello?
Yeah.
The question was, how do the national governments access the collection, right?
Yes.
The collection in the IRRI GeneBank belongs to the community, right? It does not, we don't own it. We are just a, and the national governments are not just the governments, any researchers can avail these germplasm. And we have everything announced on the web, online. We can also guide you if you need some specific kind of material based on our information about the collection. People can request and get them for free of cost. So please make use of this facility. Okay. Thank you. I hope that answers the question. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Romeya. The next question is to Dr. Tony again. So how do the Philippine corn farmers usually store their harvest?
Well, it depends. There are farmers who have the capability to put up their own storage facilities, and they are the lucky ones. They can manage well their harvest. But there are also those who sell their products coming immediately from the fields. After harvest, there are buyers waiting for the products to be bought and transferred to bigger warehouses.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Tony. That question came from Ma'am Lourdes Mistal. So the next question is for IRRI again. So how do you, does IRRI observe access and benefit sharing mechanism in its collect and access and distribution of rice germplasm?
Yes, IRRI GeneBank is fully compliant with the international policies. And for your information, all our collection, we come under the plant treaty, and all our collections are and distributions are all based on SMTAs. So even though the access and benefit sharing is indirectly followed, since it's an SMTA based, we have no issues. We follow all the regulatory policies. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is to Dr. Tony again. Came from Ms. Helen Yu. Is there any isolation requirement when producing the hybrid seeds in the field to ensure purity of seeds?
Yeah, the answer is yes. Corn being naturally cross-pollinated, and pollen is carried by the wind to far distances. There has to be some measures to prevent outcrossing, and so that only the proper combination is proper parental combination is produced in hybrid seed production. And this can be done in two ways. One is through temporal isolation or through playing with the timing. So that's only the parents that will be, flowering at the same time will be able, so that only the parents, so that the parents will flower at the same time and exclude other parentals. The other strategy is through spatial isolation, meaning distances, keep the distance away from the other parents, and that's usually like 200 meters distance from the other parentals to avoid the contamination of pollen from the parents that are not intended to be used. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tony. The question goes again to IRRI. We know that the GR rice has already been approved, the golden rice. So, and this puts the Philippines at the global forefront in leveraging agricultural redress to research to address a vitamin A deficiency. So has DA Field Rice or IRRI identified the community in the Philippines having the issue of vitamin A deficiency in order for the community to have this access on golden rice? So have you identified the community in Philippines? Thank you.
Anna, I think I can answer the question.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so right now we are, of course, through the leadership of the AFIL RISE, mm-hmm. We are developing a deployment plan that has identified pilot deployment areas in the Philippines. There will be seven pilot sites, seven provinces representing Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. We are just conducting, Field Rice is just conducting the necessary preparations so that we could already start the coordination work. But basically, these provinces have been identified due to the malnutrition status. So that's based on the most recent National Nutrition Survey conducted by the government's nutrition survey, Food and Nutrition Research Institute of the Department of Science and Technology. And also there are other factors that should be considered, like the rice production and other factors. So there are already seven provinces, like I said, from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. I'm just not at a liberty to mention the specific sites, but these are the provinces of Quirino, one in Region 5 in the Bicol region, and then one in Region 6 and one in Region 8, and then three in Mindanao. So I don't have the specific sites, pardon, but definitely we are looking at pilot sites, and we will make the necessary announcements as soon as they are available. Thank you,
Ms. Eileen. So I have here again a question from Sir Alexander Magbanwa. Though a thorough processing has been done, but we cannot avoid that problems may occur, such as slow germinations. This could only be observed after the farmer seeded or planted it in the field or farm. Is producer or owner of the seeds will replace the seeds in the fastest possible time? So, Dr. Tony?
Yeah, I can answer that. Yeah, it's true that seed companies, you know, do all what they can to prevent, you know, or to ensure high quality seeds from the field to the seed processing, packing, delivery to dealers until they reach the farmers. During the, you know, in the supply chain, there are areas where they have limited control. Like when it reaches the dealers, we can only, talk to the dealers, please do this and do that to ensure high germination. But sometimes there are things beyond our control. And when things happen like that, companies, including Corteva, have programs that, that would help farmers recover their investment. Like it can be in the form of replacing the seed, or in the form of some discount, or some advice from the people on the ground, from our agronomists and sales team, to make sure that the farmers are guided how to handle when they get to these kinds of situations. So yeah, the seed companies, as part of their product stewardship, help coordinate with farmers to make sure that, you know, what they are getting, what they are paying for, is what they get in terms of product quality and in terms of product performance.
Thank you, Dr. Tony. Again, I have a question here to IRRI again. How soon IRRI will make available biofortified rice with zinc and iron?
So basically, we're still at the field trial stage. So it will still take some time. Similarly, hopefully much shorter time when we, for approval, hopefully we could submit our dossier at a shorter time. But I cannot give a definite timeline on that. But at this stage, we're conducting confined tests, and we'll be doing a field trial in a different location, probably hopefully next year, while the regulatory studies are ongoing.
Okay, thank you, Sir Norman. Question again to Dr. Tony. What came from Helen Yu? What is the main stewardship considerations when producing GM corn seeds? When you produce GM corn seeds than conventional seeds, so what's the difference between?
I was just typing my message to that, but let me just mention it here. So first, product stewardship is all encompassing, from the time research is being done in the lab until product proof of concept, product development, product commercialization, until full out from the market. So that's the scope of product stewardship. But when we talk about stewardship specific to GM, so in addition to the usual product quality, purity in terms of genetic purity or physical purity, agronomic performance or response to our farmers, whatever queries they have, specific considerations for stewardship for GM seeds include IRM, as I presented, insect resistance management, by coming up with the appropriate refuge, what kinds of refuge, what's the proportion, how to deploy it. And we also cover weed resistance management. If the product has herbicide tolerance trait, then we have to implement weed resistance management to make sure that, the efficacy of the weed control trait is still there, and, some strategies to monitor any possible emergence of weed resistance and how to manage those populations if ever they arise. So those are the two important components of stewardship product stewardship when it comes to GM seeds in the Philippines, insect resistance management, and weed resistance management. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Tony. I have here a question to IRRI and Corteva. This is a question for both IRRI and Corteva because different countries have different standards for seed quality. So what are the factors used to classify, for example, in IRRI for rice seeds and for Dr. Tony for corn seeds? So what are the factors? Because different countries have different standards. Dr. Tony first?
Yeah, Telma, I can start. I think the standard, the parameters would be very similar or identical. It's only the numbers, you know. It's a little higher or lower for some countries. And I don't have the details to that, but I agree with you. There could be differences as to the exact parameters in terms of the values, but in terms of what are the parameters, I think those are the same, like I mentioned, genetic purity, physical purity, germination rate,
but they have different standards.
Yeah, they have different parameters. But as to the specific considerations why, it might have something to do with the weather or the environment in those countries, whether it's tropical or temperate country.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Tony. How about for rice? Who can answer for IRRI? The factors used to classify rice seeds because different countries have different standards. So how about in Philippines? What do you use here in the Philippines?
Dr. Venu or Monette, would you like to take this question?
Could you repeat the question, please? Sorry, I couldn't hear it very well.
Yeah, because different countries have different standards for seed quality. And so what are the factors used to classify, for example, rice seeds?
So the question was, what are the factors to qualify for rice quality?
Yeah, the rice seeds quality, correct.
Yeah, so quality varies depending on the purpose, right? So for example, if it is a gene bank purpose, then our qualities, the standards are slightly different. Mm-hmm. If it is meant for a breeder's seeds, mm-hmm. or if it is meant for a commercial purposes, that is distribution to farmers. Mm-hmm. For example, in our case, when we say quality, for us, quality means having very high viability, at least 85% viability. This is very important. Then quality means absence of any diseases and pests on the seeds. So if we find any such things, we normally discard them. We don't keep them, or we grow them again and make sure that these diseases are cured or removed, or we get the fresh batch of seeds for this. For us, quality also means absence of impurities. Impurities could be anything. It could be wheat seeds. It could be mixtures of other crop, or it could be mixture of other varieties of rice itself. So from a gene bank perspective, these are important. And if you look at even the breeders' varieties, or if it is a variety for commercially given, these parameters more or less holds true. But the relative percentage may vary. For example, we say 85% viability, but sometimes when it is for commercial, maybe it's slightly more. It may be a few percent higher than what it is. So this is how things vary. But you know, if any seed technology person would be there, he could give a better perspective. That's my take on that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ramila.
Atitelma.
Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to add something to your question. Speaking of quality standards, many of these are mandated by the government. So there is a minimum quality standard for commercial seeds. But What's good to note is that the seed companies exceed that that parameter. The standards are usually higher than what is set by the government. So that's a good news, good info for
Because it's good. It's good if we have harmonized standards for quality rice and corn. So the question goes to Dr. Tony again, and also for IRRI. Is there any halal rice and corn seeds developed or provided by your organization? Is there any research conducted in producing halal rice and corn seeds? Dr. Tony first?
Yeah, my understanding is that the existing crops are naturally halal. That's my understanding. And if you make them GM or genetically modified, the halal status of the crop will depend on the source of the transgene. The source of the transgene, if the source is halal, then you transfer it to your transgenic crop, the product will still be halal. But if the source is considered non-halal, then the output will be non-halal. That's the general impression that I got. But as to the specific details, I don't have right now.
Okay, and how about for IRRI? Is there any halal rice now or developed or provided by IRRI? Or is there any research conducted?
Basically, similar to Dr. Bonnie's answer. So it really depends on the source. So for us, we really don't have a research on halal rice, but for GM rice, usually our sources of the genes are from plants. So yes, so anything from animal, it would change the classification. But basically, we don't have. As far as I'm aware, I'm not aware of any research on rice. Right.
Okay, thank you, Sir Norman. There is a question to IRRI again from Sir Alexander Magbanua. Does IRRI also developing herbicide-ready and insect-resistant rice, just like GM insect-resistant corn or herbicide-resistant corn?
As of now, we are not developing any herbicide tolerant rice. We're more focused on disease resistance, but through conventional breeding. Although we're doing some gene editing work for papier liquide. But as of now, there's no development yet if we're going to pursue any work on developing this pest resistant crop, or there might be already some through conventional breeding, but through GM, we're not doing that yet.
Okay. Thank you, Sir Norman. We still have a lot of questions in the Q&A box, but due to time constraints, we will answer your questions via email. So, and now, before we get to the super fun part of every session, may we just ask you a minute or two from your time to answer our evaluation poll. And the poll will be flashed on your screen and you just have to click on your feedback for this session. This is a day 5, so please evaluate based on the topics. Importance of GeneBank in crop improvement, extremely satisfied, average, dissatisfied, and extremely dissatisfied. Importance of seed quality and virtual tour of seed processing plant. Extremely satisfied, average, dissatisfied, extremely dissatisfied. And overall, how will you rate this session? Extremely satisfied, average, dissatisfied, and extremely satisfied. Okay. Bowie, can we have the result? Yes. So for number one, extremely satisfied, 57%, and satisfied, 36%. And oh, extremely, there is an extremely dissatisfied. Importance of seed quality, 45% and 48%. And how overall satisfied and extremely satisfied. Okay. So thank you very much for your feedback. And we will use this information to improve and better our future webinars. So the next part will be, I will be giving you the synthesis of the five-day FX program. Like on the first day, the overview of modern biotechnology and GMOs was presented, and we were able to understand how the GMOs are made, and also the overview of the new plant breeding innovation was presented. And on the second day, the overview of the biosafety regulations was discussed, presenting the appropriate safety guidelines and regulation of genetically modified organisms with emphasis on environment and food safety assessment, and also the commercialized of BT corn and GABA tomato in Japan was also presented. And on the third day, it highlighted the overview of science communication, wherein the speaker shared how do we inform and educate the public about biotechnology. We have also heard experiences from other countries like China, Indonesia, Japan, and how they communicate biotech in those countries. And on the fourth day, or yesterday, we have heard the experience of several farmers from Vietnam, Philippines, Pakistan, and Bangladesh in commercializing biotech crops. And today, we know more about the importance of high-quality seeds and its benefits to the farmers. We have known that the quality of seeds is considered as an important factor for increasing yield, and its use helps greatly in higher production per unit area and to attain the food security in our country. I could say that this week has been a learning experience for everyone. So moving on, a very important part of the program for us is to hear a message from our supportive executive director of CropLife Philippines. So let us all welcome Sir Ed De Luna. Sir Ed, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, Thelma. Can you hear me loud and clear?
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. The past 5 days, we witnessed a lot of sharing and discussions, impressing upon us the importance of biotechnology, including seeds, and the accompanying regulatory framework, its benefits and contribution to food security and nutrition, climate change adaptation, poverty alleviation, and others. The take-home message that I would like to impart is innovations in technology like that of biotech must be shared and communicated to as many people as possible without regard to territories, ethnic, and culture, so that the widest range of adoption can be achieved without doubt, but solely on scientific evidence and considerations. This, to my mind, is the importance or value of the 15th Pan-Asia Farmer Exchange Program. With that, let me take due notice and appreciation to all our resource speakers, experts and panelists and moderators during the 5-day online program. Thank you so much. To the organizing team from BCP, CLA, and CLP, notably Sonny, Winsper, Thelma, Aabe, Beth, Bowie, and company, to all of you, a profound gratitude is in order. Salamat sa inyong lahat. Finally, to all the participants across Area Pacific, thank you. Let's continue to be advocates and ambassadors and adopters of technology innovation. Salamat po. I now officially close this 15th Pan-Asia Farmers Exchange Program. Stay safe. God bless everyone. Mabuhay.
Thank you, Sir Ed, for that inspiring words. CropLife Asia is truly thankful to co-organize this event yearly with CropLife Philippines and Biotech Technology Coalition of the Philippines. Now we move on to the last part of the program. This is a very exciting part, I should say, because we are giving away the $20 shopping vouchers. So the mechanics are simple. We will show one question and you have to type the answer on the chat box on your screen, chat box. The first three persons to get the correct answer wins. Are you ready? So is everyone ready? So, okay, let's do a countdown. We will show the question in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. These are all characteristics of quality seeds, except high genetic purity and physical purity, high germination, free from pest, disease, and weeds, treated with colorant and pack using innovative materials, optimum moisture content for storage. What is not the characteristic of high quality seeds? So,
do we have winners now?
So before we announce the winners, Dr. Tony, can you please discuss why except that one?
Yeah, can you show that?
While waiting?
Can you show the question again?
Tita Tel?
Yes.
Wait,
meron?
Do we have three?
So the question is, these are all characteristics of high quality seeds except letter A is a quality of good high quality seeds. It's having high genetic and physical purity. Letter B as well, it refers to high germination rate and vigor. Letter C as well, being free from pests, diseases, and weeds. Letter D is no, because colorant treatment is optional. And even the use of packaging materials that are innovative is not necessarily mean that you have high quality seeds. It can help, but it's not a requirement. Letter E is yes, because it has the optimum moisture content for storage. So the correct answer here is letter D. This is not necessarily a characteristic of high quality seeds. Treating with colorant and packing using innovative materials.
Wow, we have the winner. Congratulations to the winners of the $20 shopping voucher. Number one is Joshua Israel Sumage. Josh, Karil Olbido, and Pauline Natalie Ordillo. Parang these are by BS Biotech from UPLB. I'm not mistaken. So congratulations to the winners. We will get in touch with you through email on how to claim your prizes. Once again, I'm Thelma Soriano, and see you again tomorrow, and see you again next time, next year. Thank you for participating in the 15th Pan-Asia Farmers Exchange Program. Thank you very much all. Bye-bye.